Hey, in this tutorial, I'd like to cover each way of how you can create particle systems in Touch Designer. I'm not gonna go into a very deep explanation of each because I already have tutorials on some of them, and for others, I will refer to other creators. The goal here is to give you a brief overview so that you could choose the best solution for your project, and hopefully it will save you some time. I will also compare each method considering the flexibility, efficiency, and beginner friendliness. The last one, of course, is very subjective, so it's not applicable to every beginner. I'll start with the most beginner-friendly way, which technically isn't particle system at all, but it may look like the one and you can achieve fascinating results with it. What you will need here is some SOAP connected to the geometry component, a render top, camera, you don't need light. The main thing here is a line mat, which despite its name makes the geometry look like particles. By default it looks like a wireframe, but you can disable the lines here, then go to the point tab and enable points. You can choose another loop instead of points. Other options are not available, so if you need something else, you may want to skip this method. You can tweak the size of the particles here, but also you may go to the setup tab. And line material has a nice feature that you can define two different sizes for particles on the foreground and on the background. The same goes for color in the point tab. As I said, you need a geometry shape as an input, and this geometry should have a lot of polygons, because line material draws points on the intersections of polygons. So if you add, let's say, a sphere SOAP, make sure its type is set to polygon, and the frequency which defines the number of divisions is set to a decent value. The downside of this method is that it's pretty resource intensive, since you have to use SOAPs with lots of polygons. So maybe it's not a good idea to make real-time content with that, especially interactive, but if you need this to render the outcome or just to turn a 3D shape to particles, it does the job. Also, you can't apply any typical forces or set different colors for particles. So I wouldn't call it flexible, but it's really beginner friendly, and honestly, I saw really beautiful things done with that method. So check out the creators I mentioned below the video. And going back to the setup, when it comes to particles, post-processing often really matters. I have this custom component here that just blurs stuff on the background, adds some glow effect, and sets color. It's not much, but really helps to speed up the process when you sketch things on the go or test your ideas. I will include this as a separate talk to the project file. Alright, that's it with the alignment, and let's move on. The second way to create particles is to use Particles GPU component, which you can find in the palette under the Tools tab. This is a full-fledged particle system, which means that you can define not only the amount of particles, but also their lifetime, some forces, and other common parameters. This method is pretty flexible, since it allows you to modify a lot of things and have access to basic parameters. In my opinion, it is user-friendly, you can learn how to use it very quickly, and it is also good in performance, because all the main calculations are being made on the GPU here. I already have a tutorial on that component, and I will leave the link in the description, but let's have a brief overview now. First of all, there is a particle source tab, where you can set different shapes that will generate particles. If you want to distribute them along the screen, go with the rectangle and position it in order to fit the screen. If you want to use an external source of particles, like 3D model or image, check out my other tutorials. The next tab is the material tab. It has some predetermined options, but I like to set the material to custom and attach my own, so that I could make particles semi-transparent and set alpha. For example, you can add a constant material that ignores the light component, so you don't need one, and enable blending in the common tab. I also like to set the source color parameter to 1 minus destination alpha. Disabling depth test sometimes also makes sense, because it cuts out the transparent areas with 0 alpha, but I found that I like keeping it when my particles are really small. If you're making an installation with bigger particles and maybe some texture attached, make sure you've disabled depth test or set it to not equal. In case you want to use custom texture, just attach it to the material instead of circle. In the render, you set your output resolution. Fade parameters regulate the time needed for particle to appear or disappear from the screen. Here you set the color. It's just white by the default, but you can set 2 by choosing the random option. If you choose source input and connect some top operator, it will take colors from there. Velocity and turbulence colorize particles according to the movement. And the next 2, age lookup and velocity lookup, well, they are working the same way, but they refer to the moon color operator that we can tweak. That slash means that this operator is located inside the component. Well, this is a chop, and I don't think it's very convenient to set colors in chops, so what I usually do is I create a ramp top. You can set the resolution height to 1, while the width will define the number of shades connected instead of top. And set your own palette. Here you attach the camera. If I leave this empty, the system will switch to the internal camera, which you can control by clicking this icon in the right bottom corner and navigating the mouse over the component viewer. It's not always convenient, so you can attach a custom camera, where you will have more precise control. There are overlay parameters below. I guess they control the same thing as the parameters in the material do. I personally always leave it at the default settings. Next, forces. We have 4 of them here, and to enable the force, you need to set magnitude to some value above 0 and also set a direction. And for turbulence, which is basically a noise, we have a period and seed parameters. You can animate this noise in the turbulence transform. There are other types of forces, and the easiest way to work with them is to go inside, find a null extra operator. That's a null, so we need the previous one, copy it and paste here. This error is not crucial, just delete the script and attach instead. And now we can use some other forces like attraction or ripple. There are 3 of them, if I'm not mistaken. And you can switch between them by changing the force type value. It's very useful for installations where you want to use your, let's say, hands coordinates to interact with particles, because you simply attach your hands coordinates to the first values over here. Optical flow is also a great algorithm that allows particles to react on movement. There is a great tutorial about optical flow on the Interactive Immersive channel, and I will leave a link to this tutorial in order to prevent this one from being too long. Rotation settings are pretty straightforward. First of all, you can make your particles face camera, like I did, or you can make them rotate along each axis, which is more representable with bigger particles. You can adjust the speed. Also make sure that randomization is enabled, otherwise they will disappear periodically all at once. Now let's go to the Particles GPU tab. Here you define the amount of particles, their lifetime. Current settings mean that the lifetime of each particle is somewhere from 10 to 12 seconds, I guess, plus fade-in and fade-out values. It's better to set life variants to at least 1, unless you need particles to be born and disappear all at once. Or you can just set the life type to random. We also have this really handy recede button. You can attach the keyboard chop to it to be able to update easily when you are working with this component. Next, we have size parameters. It can be a constant, or random between these values, or driven by age or velocity. Again, if you want to tweak it, you simply go inside and watch for null size operator. Okay, that's a null, so that's what we need. You can tweak it here or just copy and paste like that. You can work the same way with the velocity. Next, the bounding box. We can adjust its size and set a behavior. The drag parameter controls force's speed all at once. By limiting the velocity, you can achieve more coherent movement, and it can prevent particle system from sudden chaotic movements, which can be useful in interactive installations or audio-reactive networks when you urge to create sort of meditative vibe while the input signal can be unpredictable. Speed is almost the same as drag, but it affects not only forces, but all particle movements, including their life. Maximum particles just limits the amount of particles, I believe. That prevents the system from crash in case there are too many of them. And pause is clear. Alright, that was a particle GPU component, and let's move on. The next method is called instancing. Instancing is a technique used to render multiple copies of the same object with minimal memory usage in computations. The particle GPU component, which we've just observed, also uses instancing to render particles inside the component, but I will show you an example of a basic setup created by Scratch. So here I have this regular setup with a geometry component, a render top, camera and a light. The box SOP that is plugged into the geometry represents one single particle. You can use any SOP here, just avoid high polygonal models, or if you just need a tiny particle, you can create them by using an add SOP with add points enabled. Connect it to the convert SOP and choose convert to particles per point option. This can really improve the performance. I also found out that using just a flat rectangle SOP is good in performance, so I usually use this when I don't need a 3D particle. But in this example, I want to get back to the box. The main magic happens in the instance tab of the geometry component. Here we refer to the jobs that gives us an information about where each particle, which is called instance in that case, should locate, what size, rotation, and color it should have. The amount of particles is the length of these channels. Each channel should have the same length in order to make it work, and initially it's defined by this sphere's polygon number, plus noise that generates this structure in the center. It's for position, and for size and rotation, I just use noise values to take the information about length from the position with the info job. You can get some interesting results by tweaking noise parameters. Technically, you can create almost any particle system with this method, and its possibilities are limited only by your PC power and knowledge. However, it may be not very straightforward for beginners, especially if you want to implement some forces or specific behavior, since it may take a while to figure out how the math behind it works. Also, I wouldn't suggest to use it if you have a really big amount of particles, like hundreds or thousands, because calculating big amounts of data in jobs is not super efficient. However, there is a way to improve the performance, which I'll talk about next. Another variation of instancing is using top operators for positioning instead of jobs. This approach is very close to writing a shader, where the calculations are being made on GPU, which is faster since it supports parallel calculations. But in my opinion, this technique requires sort of a mental shift to get in, and especially to be able to create your own networks, because here we operate pixel values instead of XYZ coordinates. If you're really interested in the possibilities of this method, I recommend you to check out the artists I mentioned below the video. They really mastered this technique and make great stuff with it. But I've prepared a simple network to introduce you to the basic principles. Here I have an operator that stores position values that are referenced in the geometry component. Unlike the previous example, it is a top, which may look pretty odd, but fortunately Touch Designer has this feature when you can display color values as position values in 3D space. I recommend you to enable this when you are working with tops in such a way. First of all, you need to create a UV map. It's just a grid of values from 0 to 1 that are stored in texture, where the red channel stores x coordinates and the green stores y coordinates. I have a whole video about this, check it out if you want to understand it in details. The resolution defines the number of points or particles in our case. Make sure these nodes are set to 16 or 32-bit float format, otherwise your values can get cropped. A simple example of what you can do next is connecting the output of reorder top to the noise. The noise top will displace the positions of points by adding random values to them. Sometimes you may want to use the point transform top to scale or translate the point cloud as if it was a SOP. A bit more advanced example is when we create a particle system where each particle has a life, meaning that particles constantly appear and then disappear from the screen. In such networks, we use noise as a source of random values. A feedback top is responsible for the loop. Connected to the operator downstream in the feedback network, it stores the values of the prior frames, which we can compare with the current frame values. Threshold serves like a conditional. For example, here we check if the value is greater than 0, meaning if the particle is alive, and here if it's not. Multiply, over, subtract, and other composite tops act like simple mathematical operations. When we work with chops, these operations are being calculated on the CPU sequentially, which can be slow if we have a lot of particles or if the mass is complex. Tops, on the contrary, are being processed on GPU, which supports parallel calculations, so it can process the same math operations faster, but you need to store everything in tops. Here I also have a feedback effect taken from the palette, which makes the particles look like trails. With that being said, I recommend you to check out creators who are really good in this technique, and I will go next to the last method. The last, and this time the least, method is using the particle SOP. Honestly speaking, I wasn't sure if that's a good idea to include this method at all, because it has more disadvantages rather than advantages. Its main downside is that it's being processed on CPU as any other SOP, which is an outdated method to make particle systems. Everything you can do with particle SOP, you can do with particle's GPU component or instancing, so I don't see any reason why you would need to use this, honestly. But if you know, write me in the comments and I will be curious to read. But anyway, let's have a look on what we have here. I use the box SOP animated with noise as the source of particles. This box serves as an attractor, and I also render it as a wireframe in the scene. So, the particle SOP is the main operator here. In the particle step, you'll find all the general parameters. The most important are mass, which affects the speed and reactiveness. Drag also affects the speed. Burst is the amount of particles. Here we have the life parameters. The particle's movement is defined by the forces. Now I have a turbulence turned on and wind along z-axis, so it moves the particles towards us. You can also use a force SOP with the metapole attached to create your own point of attraction of forces. Particle SOP has a great set of operator snippets, so I recommend you to check it out. So you can connect your hand's coordinates to the metaball and make this interactive. But again, I don't recommend to do that, better use particle's GPU instead or any other technique from this video. So that was the last method. I hope this video was helpful, and see you in the next one. Bye!